So after talking about this concentration inequality, we return back to the stochastic bandit setting. We define what is the regret would be interested in the stochastic bandit setting, and then defined the pseudo regret, which we want to take it as a performance measure, and we want to give performance guarantee on that. And we concluded by giving in the last class, a regret decomposition result, right? Now we will move on and try to see what is the best bound or what kind of bounds we can give on the pseudo regret, okay? Okay, so we know that let's say we have a bandit instance. Where we have this set of k distributions, one distribution assigned to each of the arms. And we said that the sample, when you are going to play an arm A, the samples are drawn. The random variable x that corresponds to the sample that are drawn from arm A, that will be distributed according to distribution A, right? And we said that expected value of x, in this case let us say we denote it as mu A, okay, where this guy x is drawn according to this distribution mu A. Now our goal is to basically our goal boils down, if you want to minimize the regret, our goal boils down to what? Identify an arm which has the largest value of this mean value, right? And what would we say in the last time? Through our discussion on concentration inequality, we said that if we have many samples from a particular arm, how to estimate this parameter mu A. And we said that if you are going to use sample mean as my estimator, how far the estimated mean will be from the true mean after a certain number of rounds. We gave a bound on that, right? We specifically focused on the cases. The case where this mu A's are all sub Gaussian distributed, and for that we gave this concentration bounds. Okay, now let us start thinking about how to estimate this means, but our goal is to not just estimate this but to quickly estimate this so that I do not incur regret after some time. Now what could be our strategy? Now we are interested in to come up with the policies for this, right? So what are the policies? Policies or algorithm, what? So any thoughts on how we will go about this? Let us say you have been asked to, we have been given n rounds. And your goal is to come up with a policy pi such that you want to is this, which in the last class we discussed that this can be given also as until there are k arms. So this is nothing but expected value of right, where we defined as di equals to okay, and also we said the last time, suppose some particular arm is optimal. So, throughout we will assume without loss of generality that my arm 1 is optimal, that is the mean which has the highest value is the one with arm 1. Okay. So, we know this, but the algorithm does not know this. Okay. So, this is just for our analysis point of view. So, because of this, if arm 1 is the optimal one, delta 1 is going to be 0 and delta 2 will be positive and delta 3 will be positive. And also we will assume for time being that the optimal arm is the unique, right. So, if mu 1 is the highest mean, all the other means mu 2 and all, mu 2 all others are going to be strictly smaller than the mean of arm 1, that is why the arm 1 is the optimal arm. So, we know that this delta 1 is going to be 0, but this delta 2 and all are going to be positive. So, if I want to minimize my regret, I need to ensure that the expected number of place of my arm 2 and others should be as small as possible, or I want to keep them low. Okay. So, now I am going to use the terminology that arm 1, since it has the highest mean, I am going to call it as optimal arm and all other arms are suboptimal arms. Okay. Okay. Any thought on how to do this? Just like some random ideas. Okay. So, first we will start with something called this explore and commit algorithm. So, one obvious thing is you sample each of these arms for certain number of rounds and then find the means of sample means of each of these arms, and then maybe after that you just play the one which has the highest mean. Okay. But here the question is how much time I should sample each one of them so that I get the good estimates all of them. Once I am sufficiently confident these estimates are good, maybe then I do not need to explore any more further, then just play the one which has the highest mean after that words, right. So, let us that one natural policy, let us be is called explore and commit. Now, how the algorithm looks in this case? So, for this algorithm, we need to tell how many rounds it need to explore. So, explore, let us say we have to tell the algorithm sample each of these arms this many times. That has to go as an input to this algorithm, right. So, let us say input is that number m and of course, and k is the number of arms. And then what this algorithm does? The algorithm is going to play arm 1 m times, arm 2 again m times, arm 3 m times. So, there are k arms. In the first k m number of rounds, it will sample each of the arms m number of rounds. After that, it finds the estimates of all of them and commits to the one with the highest mean. I am just going to write that. So all of you understand what is this? This is T mod K, okay? And till the first mk number of rounds, what it is going to do? It is going to do T mod K. So suppose let's say T equals to 1, it is going to be what? 1 mod K 1. So what it is going to play? It is going to play 1 mod K, right? Let's say K is some greater than 1. It is going to be this term, why it is going to be 1? Yeah, but plus 1 there is, right? It is going to be 2 in that case. So like that, when T equals to 2, it is going to play arm 3. When T equals to 4, sorry, T equals to 3, it is going to play. And when T becomes K, it becomes 0 and it is going to play arm 1. And it continues, right? So it is going to play the arms in a round robin fashion. It starts with actually 2, 3, 4, 5 up to K, and then it comes with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 like that. Until that is, it is going to do mk number of rounds. And for t greater than mk, so what is mu hat k here? So we are going to define mu I hat at time t. That means the notation here is the estimates of arm I have at round t, and this is going to be so this is the number of samples averaged till time t, right? So what is the numerator doing? It is, so first focus on this denominator. It is counting on the number of plays of arm I till round t. And what is numerator doing? Numerator is taking the sum of all the samples that comes from arm I till round t, right? So this notation is saying that whenever is in the sth round, if is equals to I, then only this term is retained. So it is retaining only those samples that you have collected from arm I till round t. Which one? Yeah, this has to be ISS. So once you have hit mk number of rounds, okay, what you will do? You will at that round, you will see which arm has the highest mean, and after that, that's it. You keep on playing the same arm which has the highest mean. You are not going to change the estimates after that. Now the, so that is why we are saying that we have explored till the first mk rounds, and after mk round we are just committing ourselves to the one which has the highest empirical mean in that till that round. Okay, now if I am going to do like this, what is the performance I am going to get? Okay, so now let us try to bound this. Okay, now let's count pi So how many rounds I have played arm I till n rounds, right? You know that for the first m rounds you have played arm I, that has been guaranteed by this first part, right? Okay, and then for s equals to mk onwards, you do not know whether which arm is played, that depends on which one has the highest min. So, let us right. Okay. And now from this round mk plus 1 and n, whether you have played arm I or not, depending on in the mkth, after the mkth round, whether the arm I term happened to be the best one or not, right? So let us try to do this. So what is this is going to be then? This is going to be, so this depends whether I am going to play or not, only depends whether on the mkth round I happen to be the best or not. So that is going to be n minus mk times indicator So I am saying that, so now after this mk plus 1 to n rounds, I will be playing arm I only if mu I hat of k, this guy happens to be larger than the other arms, right, all computed at mkth round. So at the end of this mkth round, I have computed the empirical means of all of them, and I know that after for t is going to be greater than mk, I am going to play arm I only if its empirical mean happens to be larger than others, right? Fine. Okay, now so this is a constant that has been given to me as an input to the algorithm. So n is also, let us assume that is given to me, the number of rounds for a given number of rounds. So what will be the expected number of plays of ti n? So this is going to be m plus n minus mk, and now if I take the expected value of this indicator, it is going to be probability of right. So now the problem boils down to how can I bound this probability? What is the probability that at the end of mk rounds my I the ham happens to be the one with the highest mean, highest empirical mean? Okay. So now let us try to focus on this term. So now, for time being, let's assume that this I'm interested in this arm I, which is other than the optimal arm. That is, I is not equals to 1. Okay, now I am interested in a bad event, right? Like I want to basically see that I have assumed my arm 1 is optimal, but what is the probability that I will end up some arm I to be empirically best, right? So if that happens, if the arm I which is not 1 happens to have a highest empirical mean compared to the arm 1, then that's a bad thing for me, right? That is going to cause regret for me. So let's consider that event and see how, if we can capture that. So what we want is, in this I want the when this happens to be larger than mu 1 hat of k, that is the mean, empirical mean of the ith arm happen to be greater than or equals to the empirical arm of the arm 1, that is the best one, right. So here I was looking at max over all the arms. Here I am just trying to replace it by the one with arm 1. So what can I say the relation between this and this? So this is basically saying mu 1 hat is greater than maximum of several terms, and mu 1 is one of the terms here in the max. Okay, so if I am just going to retain one of the terms here, so what is the relation between this probability and this probability? So which is going to be larger, this one is going to be larger or this is going to be larger? First one is going to be larger, right? And anyway, left hand side is the same. So now I am saying that mu 1 being greater than equals to some larger quantity, now I am asking mu 1 to be greater than somewhat smaller quantity. Which event implies which event? So if this happens, this automatically happens, right? So which one should have a larger probability? If this A implies B, first one will have larger probability. So A implies B. So A is this event, if whenever A happens, they are saying that B happens, right? Which should be correct? Yes. Of course, this is larger. Yeah, this one is going to be more stringent, right? And this is happening, this is automatically implied. So no, upper one is more stringent. So because of that, you can check that if this is more stringent, this probability should be smaller than the other one, right? Okay. Or like maybe like we are basically saying that if this means basically we are saying, otherwise this we are saying that A is contained in, okay. So this is just like this guy is asking it to be larger than some quantity, and now you want it to be smaller than it, this quantity to be larger than somewhat smaller quantity. So this is automatically implied, but the other way is not true, right? Like suppose mu 1 hat is greater than, let us say, mu 1 hat. That does not mean that mu 1 hat is going to be greater than or equals to max over all of this. Or is that automatically implied? Actually, So we should think it like this. Suppose let us say mu 1 hat is going to be greater than or equals to mu 1 hat, and now I am looking at max. In this max, mu 1 hat is already contained, okay. So now this quantity is going to be larger than this quantity, right. So you are basically asking this to be more stringent. You want more than what is already guaranteed in this. So that also implies that this quantity has to be less than or equals to this quantity. Okay, now we have this. Let us manipulate this. What I will do is, I want to, okay, just I will just take both sides. Mu I is, let us say mu I minus I am taking this quantity on the other side, and now I have added minus mu I here and plus mu I. This is going to be what? Sorry, mu 1 here. This is going to be what? Mu 1 minus mu I. Is this correct? I have just done a manipulation here. I have just taken this on the other side, and there is minus mu I minus minus plus mu 1 here, and I have added the same thing over here. So now continuing this line of inequality, mu 1 hat of mu k greater than or equals to mu 1. So this is the max over j naught equals to I mu j of hat. Okay. So now this is going to be greater than or equals to probability that and by definition, what is this mu 1 minus mu I for us? Delta I, that we have defined as delta I. Okay. So this is what we have. Okay. Now recall what are these quantities. This mu hat, mu I hat is nothing but average of m samples that are obtained from I term, right. So that is how you have computed it. It is when it did it, we are taking it t equals to mk, it is looking at all the samples that are drawn from arm I till mkth round. Till mkth round we have exactly m samples, right, and this is going to be m because m, the arm I has been played m number of rounds. Okay. So this is nothing but, this quantity is nothing but average of m samples that has been drawn from arm I, and we know that arm I, these samples are iid, further the mean of arm I is mu I, right. Now we argued last time, if all my arms distributions are sub Gaussian, what this quantity is going to be? Sub Gaussian. Sub Gaussian with what parameter? Suppose assume that all my distributions are one sub Gaussian. Okay. 1 by m, why is that? So there are, so if you simplify this, it is zero sub Gaussian under root of sigma 1 square minus 1 square. Right? Yes. So, what happens? So, in our case, we said sigma 1 is 1 and sigma 2 is 2, also 1. It is. But there is also like, okay, now let us rewrite it. So, I know that for mk, the denominator becomes what? It becomes m, right? So, this is m. And what is this numerator is like? This is basically summation of, this is going to be the summation of I samples which has drawn from arm I only. That is what it is saying, right? This is XISS is the sample you are going to observe in the Sth round. But I am interested in only those samples where IS equals to I, right? So, because of if you just ignore all the places where my IS is not equals to I, if you only retain those where IS equals to I have exactly m samples in the numerator, right? So, if I just took that, it is basically going to be what? X I, and so this is basically going to be just I, right? Where I is S1 to M. So, these are all the samples of the, I even do not need to write this, okay, S. This, all the samples are coming from I term and all the samples are one sub Gaussian. So, now we have this and now we have also mu I here, right? Let us take this mu I here. This is whole of this quantity divided by mu I. We have already discussed this. So, S equals to 1 to m XIS times mu I, this whole divided by again. So, there is some small mistake we made. We did not say that these samples are coming from one sub Gaussian. We said that these samples, when you subtract from mu the mean, we said that this is one sub Gaussian. That is what we said in the last class, right? That the distributions are such that if you center this distribution, that is if you subtract the mean from the samples, those samples are one sub Gaussian. So, that is why when you write simplify this, so I have to also plot this, I am taking this entire thing here. This is going to be like this, and we know that this quantity is one sub Gaussian. Okay, now if this is one sub Gaussian and if you are going to sum this, what is this? This is going to be 1 by root m. Why is that? So, we already said that, you said that it is going to be like sigma 1 square, sigma 2 square, like this, right? We have m quantities here and first each one is like 1 by m square, right? So, 1 by m square plus 1 by m square, all equal to 1 by m square. There are m quantities like that, and if you just going to m by m square, it becomes under square root. So, it is going to be 1 by m square. So, this entire quantity here is 1 by square root m sub Gaussian. And what about this quantity? This is mu 1 here. We are just saying that all the distributions are, all we know is one sub Gaussian, right? Even though they have different the centering value that all the center distributions are one sub Gaussian. So even for the optimal arm, when you center it, that is going to be also be sub Gaussian with the same parameter. Okay. So now what about this? So I know that this guy is one sub Gaussian, 1 by m sub Gaussian, this entire thing, and this another guy is also 1 by square root m sub Gaussian. What about their difference? Okay, before difference, this entire thing is 1 by square root m sub Gaussian. What happens with the minus sign? With the minus sign is, what is this? Why is that? So, right, we have said that even if you scale it by some constant C, whether positive or negative, it does not matter. It is going to be the same 1 by square root m with that constant, and that one, that constant is 1 here. Okay, now this is 1 by square root m sub Gaussian. This quantity is also 1 by square root m sub Gaussian. And think of these are, we are adding 2 sub Gaussian random variables. And are they independent here? They are independent, right? When, what would we say? When I am going to draw a sample from an arm, it is going to be independent of the past of pulls from that arm and also independent from the pulls of other arms. Okay, so it has to be, these two are independent. And now what is the, what is this then? Then it is going to be under root 2 by m, right? Because then it is like square root of, so now this entire thing here is under root 2 by m sub Gaussian. So if this entire thing is under root square root 2 by m sub Gaussian, now I already know a result which we showed last time, which we written as one of the lemma, right? Can I apply that and find a bound for this? What is this probability? So recall that we said that probability that x is greater than or equals to epsilon, when x is a sigma sub Gaussian, what would we say? This is upper bounded by exponential minus by 2. What are sigma here? This sigma is the sub Gaussianity parameter of this x. Now this x is nothing but this entire quantity, right? And so replace this sigma by square root by 2 by m. Now what you are going to get if you do that? And your epsilon is now delta I. Now this x is this entire quantity. So if you just apply that, this probability is going to be upper bounded by epsilon minus epsilon is delta I square 2 times this sigma is going to be square root 2 by m. And if you are going to put it, we are going to get after squaring 2 by m, and this is going to be 2 times m, right? So this is nothing but epsilon times minus delta I square m by 4. So what we finally actually showed is, okay, I will just erase this part, I have rewritten there. M plus, maybe I will just m equals to n plus m minus k, and this whole quantity we have just argued that this is upper bounded by exponential equals to this. Okay. Now, once we have our bound on this expected pulse of an arm I, right? Now we can go and use our regret decomposition result to get a bound of my regret, bound on my regret. So what is that then? My pseudo regret is it is given by expected value of Ti of n I just substitute this and this quantity is upper bounded by like this. So, this is going to be what? First term is going to be mk times, sorry, if I substitute this, I am going to get m times mission. Plus n minus mk times I equals to 1 to k delta I exp minus. Which is correct. I have just substituted bound on the expected number of poles in this expression here.